My name is Claire Wilde. I want to welcome everyone to our event with Richard Wolff. He's speaking on Occupying Our Future, Cooperative Solutions to Tough Times. Richard Wolff is Professor Emeritus of Economics at the University of Massachusetts Amherst, where he taught economics from 1973 to 2008. He's currently a visiting professor in the graduate program in international affairs of the New School University, New York City. His latest book, and I understand there are more to come, is Capitalism Hits the Fan, The Global Economic Meltdown and What to Do About It. Here's the book. They have it at Book Passage, or you can order it from one of the other local bookstores. We have note cards available for questions after the talk. And again, it's great to see everybody here. And let's welcome Richard Wolff.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for being here. Thank you all for inviting me. I hope my notes here don't blow away. And I hope that I can make some of what's happening a bit more understandable. First of all, something I need to do, which I do with all the Occupy groups that I talk to, which is on behalf of an enormous number of American people, to thank you for making this movement happen, for staying with it, not only before the media decided you were real, but after the media found a group of strange Republicans running for office to be more interesting than you are. That will pass, as most of them will, but this Occupy movement is a genie that has emerged from a bottle, and no one can put that back. And I can assure you that the movement around the country of this is as impressive now, after the media attention has faded, as it was before. The forms are changing. A new movement that could do what this one did, and I'm going to talk a little bit about it, will of course lead the authorities who have no way of dealing with the issues that brought Occupy into existence to do the only thing they can do, since they cannot change those conditions or have no interest in doing it. They can only try one way or another to repress. The same leaders who celebrate democracy movements in other countries have such a terrible time when the chickens come home to roost, and it happens in their own country. In New York City, where I live and where I spent a good bit of time down at Zuccotti Park, where a lot of this started, we have the following spectacle, just to give you an idea of how absurd it can be. We have a very zero kind of fellow as mayor, a man whose only claim to fame is that he's very wealthy, which is, as you know, a major way to become a politician in the United States now. Michael Bloomberg, confronted with a movement that grew by leaps and bounds in a matter of weeks, he could do no better than to destroy it. And he destroyed it in an interesting way. First, he explained to the world, he couldn't do better than the following, that the park isn't clean enough where the young people had gathered, and the people of all ages, in fact, it wasn't clean enough. And so he had to clear the park. This is the mayor who presides over the filthiest subway system on earth, who has done nothing in his time as mayor to do anything about that. It's a city that has a system of disposing of garbage, myself included, as follows. You take it, you put it in a bag, and you throw it on the sidewalk. And during the night, the large number of creatures that inhabit our city come out and open up the garbage and distribute it in a very democratic way all over the street. This is a mayor who obviously could care less about cleanliness, but in that park, it was really important to be clean. It destroyed a good part of that man's reputation. He didn't have much of one, but the little bit he had, that was destroyed. The other part of that action, which was counterproductive, was the wonderful scene played on the televisions of New York of the bulldozers that came in and destroyed the little public library that the folks in that park had established. A collection of plastic containers with books that had been contributed and that were lent out, and there was a little record-keeping procedure. In the same week that Mayor Bloomberg destroyed the library created by Occupy, he announced the necessity, as he sees it, to reduce the number of hours that the city's public libraries are open. So he destroyed the public library created by the people in order to do what? To achieve the cleanliness he can't manage to do anywhere else. A man like that gets exactly what he deserves, which is a real major destruction of his reputation, and I'm very proud, since I have a radio program in New York City once a week for an hour, that I'm doing everything I can to help in that destruction of his reputation. All that's left really for him is to be a Republican running around explaining to people that he's not as bad as all the other Republicans, which in New York City is an effective way of moving forward. But the problem in New York City is there hardly aren't any Republicans, and so it's very hard. He's talking to a very small number of people. All right, let me turn to what I came here to talk to you about, which is the economic crisis, what is happening, how it is working itself out, and perhaps what you most care about is where it's going and what it's going to mean. Okay, let's begin. We are now in the fifth year of this economic crisis. This downturn begins in the middle of 2007, and it is important that everyone understands it has never been fixed. We now have an unemployment rate in the United States in the neighborhood of 8.5 to 9%. We've had that for the last 3 years. No appreciable change. The number of people that are unemployed in this country at this time is in the neighborhood of 15 to 20 million officially. If you add the people who have a part-time job but don't want it, they want a full-time job, and those who no longer are looking for work, a wonderful category that the Bureau of Labor Statistics in Washington calls discouraged workers. Wonderful choice. Sometimes they're also called marginal workers. That's the official category. You put them all together, it's about 15 to 15.5% of the labor force in this country, 20 to 25 million people. And nothing has been done, fundamentally nothing, for them. In 2011, we had more home foreclosures in the United States than we'd had in any year prior to that. Nothing effectively is being done to deal with that problem either. The length of time an average unemployed person is unemployed is longer than it's been in the recorded history of that statistic, which is 50 years old. For the mass of people, this economic crisis continues. Even more important, if you look at something that economists call the real wage, that's the amount of money you get adjusted for the prices you have to pay with that money that you earn. The real wage over the last 12 months dropped another 2% in the United States, having dropped for a long time. When the real wage, what you actually get for your income, keeps dropping, then the gap between the rich and the poor keeps widening. That gap, which has been widening in the United States for 35 years, uninterruptedly, and which is a large part of why we have an economic crisis. When you read in the paper, the stores are not selling enough, the goods are not selling enough, there's not enough demand, that's an indirect way of saying, for the mass of people, their purchasing power keeps being shrunken. And the result is, if you do that, then the businesses have no customers the way they did, and the whole thing grinds on at a low-key level, and that's where our economic system sits. And nothing has been done. And I'm going to come back to that. Nothing has been done. But it's always important in an economic system like ours to look not only at what's happening to the mass of people, but to look at the other side of the coin. Something which you, your movement, has taught the American people to think like this in a way that has been difficult for generations. You've made it clear that a way to look at this country is to distinguish the 99% from the 1%. That cuts through a great deal of nonsense and focuses people in a way that makes my job as a teacher and as a speaker much, much easier. So let's look at the other side of the equation, the 1%. If you take that group of people, here's the reality. Not only have they recovered from the crisis which affected them also in 2008 and 2009, but their position is relatively stronger now than it even was at the beginning of the downturn in 2007. You can see that from the pay packages that top executives in most American corporations are now able to give themselves. You can see it in the revival of the stock market, not all the way, but for most of what it lost, it has gotten that back. Those people who depend on the stock market, and a little statistics always never to forget, 1% of the shareholders in this country own 75% of the shares. So when you hear that the stock market is going up, please do not think about the 11 shares of General Motors your grandmother may have left you. That's not what's significant. What's significant is that the people who own the bulk of the shares are the ones who make the benefit that is provided by a government that throws this much money in. 2.5 years ago, led by Senator Bernie Sanders of Vermont and a few others, a demand was made on the Federal Reserve to reveal to the American people, it is after all an institution set up by the laws of the United States, how much money they had given to what banks in the dark days of 2008, 9, and 10, and actually even unto the, right to this present. And the Federal Reserve, fearful of what the American people would think if they told them, refused, and they refused repeatedly, and they were able to prevent anyone from getting that information. Mr. Obama did nothing to release that information as he could have forced them to do, and so on. It took an interesting institution, the Bloomberg Financial News Service, to go to court to force the Federal Reserve to reveal what it had done. And here's what the Federal Reserve revealed a few weeks ago, this is very recent, that they had dumped, by their calculation, $1.5 trillion, it's 1.5 trillion. The Bloomberg didn't like the way they had done the calculation. By Bloomberg's calculation, it was 7.7 trillion, and there are others who have made different calculations where it gets into the 20 trillion. The amount doesn't matter. Here's the reality. Most of the major banks of the United States, and not a few of its major insurance companies, have basically been on the government's dole for years. We do not have a private banking system. We have a banking system that has been sustained through its worst crisis by an endlessly renewed series of multi-billion dollar loans at very, very low interest rates for years. You couldn't help the people who were losing their homes because that seemed to be just too difficult and too complicated. But you were able to provide assistance to all the largest banks in the United States, and you still do. There are so many things I could tell you to give you this impression, but I'll pick just one to get this message across. Over the last 2.5 years, just to get a sense of the government's bankrolling everything, 90% of all mortgages written in the United States, for anybody, 90%, are either currently owned by the United States government or guaranteed by the United States government. In the absence of the government of the United States guaranteeing or buying all the mortgages, and to make it clear to all of you, you may have a mortgage in which you send a monthly payment to the local bank. The bank is what's called a servicer. The bank doesn't own that anymore. The bank just turns that money around and gives it to the owner. And right now, the major owner in the United States of mortgages is the United States government. Without the government either guaranteeing or buying every mortgage, your local bank wouldn't give you one. And if the local banks did not give people the wherewithal to buy housing in this country, there would be no housing market. And to make sure you understand what I'm saying, if the government didn't do that, if you owned a house, it would be worth half today of whatever it is worth, because there'd be no buyers for it. There is no way to sustain. The American economy is a basket case, dependent on the government's support at every major turn. Only the way the government is doing is giving the money at the top. And then the idea is that everybody will slowly benefit if the folks at the top get theirs. This has a name. It comes from the Great Depression of the 1930s. This is called trickle-down economics. You take care of those at the top, and then you hope for it all to trickle down. Rarely does it trickle very far, and rarely does it trickle for very long. Those at the top collect what they can, and if you get a few crumbs off the table, or if there's a byproduct, like in the case of the housing market, then you can get some benefit too. But as my statistics at the beginning showed you, for the mass of the American people, not much in the way of benefits. Less visible, something else. Even those people who have jobs, the quality of the jobs is changing, and the pay is changing, and the benefits that go with working are all changing, and they're all changing in the same direction, down. Down, down, down. Perhaps the most dramatic example is something called the two-tier labor contract. In those places where working people still have a union and still have a contract, more and more unions are signing a contract that works like this. For those workers that are working right now in this factory, in this office, in this store, we will continue to pay you the wages we've been paying you. But on one condition, that you permit us to pay those workers who replace you when you leave, you die, you retire, with another worker doing exactly the same thing to whom we will pay half of what we pay you. In the automobile industry in the United States, the going wage is about $28 an hour. Under the contract signed by the UAW, new hired workers can be hired at $14 an hour, and they are being hired in a range of $14 to $18 an hour. To get an idea of what that means, I want to invite you to take a trip, if you've never done it, sometime in the next year, and go to the city of Detroit. If you wish to see what the other side of capitalism is, go to Detroit, spend a day or two, you will not believe, and I cannot describe, I lack the words, what that society has become, what that city has become. Block after block of burnt out houses. It's a landscape that people would otherwise associate with a bombed out Beirut or something of that on that scale. But it's here in the United States. And in other parts of the United States, like Cleveland and other cities, you get replica of this. Very, very dangerous development. Nothing is happening. In Detroit, there's actually a takeover underway in which the government of the state of Michigan is going to take over the city of Detroit because they have to cut all the services and the local politicians can't do it, so the governor is going to do it for them. The fact that the local government in Detroit is Democratic and African American, and that the governor is white and Republican, I'll give you one idea of what's coming down the pike in that part of the United States, and those will be big headlines. If I had time, I would talk to you about other parts of the destruction of this economic crisis and all of its costs. I don't have the time, but a couple of hints to you before we get on with the business of today. To the south of us is a country that cannot function as a country anymore. It's called Mexico. Mexico is, among other things, a victim of this economic crisis in a way you need to understand, because in the highest levels of the United States government, there's something just shy of panic about what's going on in that quote-unquote, and I'm quoting from White House conversations, the failed state. That's the way this is referred to. Mexico lived for the last 10 years on a kind of borrowed time. Because of the NAFTA agreements, the Mexican economy, being now open to the United States and vice versa, experienced the arrival of American corporations, one of whom was Walmart. And what Walmart did, to make a complex story simple, was to arrive in Mexico and to create department stores of the Walmart type, which completely outcompeted and destroyed thousands, millions of small shopkeepers in every Mexican village who handled the rice and the beans and the cloth and the pots and pans, the usual materials for people to live. They were destroyed. Likewise, all kinds of crops from the United States that they couldn't compete with and so on. The result was for millions of Mexicans, they had a choice over the last 20 years, 15 years, depending on how you count. They could stay in Mexico where there was neither work, nor future, nor economic survival, or they could go someplace else, and you all know better than we do in the East where they went. And they came here because there was no way to survive where they were. This solved two problems for Mexico. One, the inability to provide work for millions and millions of their own citizens without a revolutionary change at home. That was a big solution for them. Second, those workers who came to the United States sent back to Mexico huge amount of money. It's called remittances. Huge amounts. In Mexico, it was the second or third largest export. That is, it brought in more money than almost anything else Mexico has to sell. They got rid of the people for whom they had no work and no life, and they acquired a vast new inflow of money. Best of all possible worlds. Starting in 2007, the thing that went up started coming down. The workers stopped coming from Mexico. There was no point. There's no work here. They stopped coming, and they started returning. And because there was no work here, and particularly in the housing industry where so many Mexican immigrants were employed across the country, they also had nothing to send back anymore. So they went home, which Mexico can't handle, and the money stopped flowing. The next time you read about pitched battles between police and drug gangs, with the ability to identify who's in which side being very, very difficult, you know, given the overlap, even more than in our society, the problem is not a problem of drugs. That's the symptom. The underlying problem is there is no Mexican economy that can survive. You have enclaves that the government is protecting, and the rest is a free zone. That's a casualty of this economic crisis. Nothing is happening to deal with that problem at all. It just sits and gets worse until it blows up. This is a society that can no longer in our country handle its problems. And the Occupy movement is itself another symptom of that. If I can interrupt for a minute and just tell you something personally, here I am, a critic of the American economic system. In case any of you don't know this, I'm going to let you on a secret. I don't like capitalism. And I never have. I'm a professional economist. I've been a professor of economics all my life. And I don't mind telling you, because I enjoy the humor of it, that I'm not only an economist by profession, but I'm a product of the American university system, of the very fanciest of them. I went to Harvard as an undergraduate, and when I graduated, I came out here. I went to school at Stanford for a year, and I got a degree there, and when I finished there, I went back east, and I finished my education at Yale. See, by American standards, I'm a poster boy for the American elite education. And I think capitalism is a disaster. And I learned that from the people who have been distressed ever since that something about their education ended up in such a form. But here's the reason I tell you this. I've been therefore critical of this system and how it works with its results most of my adult life. But in the last 2 years, something dramatically changed. I have done more public speaking and appeared on more radio and television programs in the last 2 years than in the previous 40 of my life. It's very important that you understand that. I cannot meet the invitations I now get. I turn down more invitations now than I ever received in the past. That's how serious this is. And not only is it different, and not only has it really mushroomed since the Occupy movement, but the quality of these interviews that I have is different. I was telling a couple of the folks who invited me a few minutes before I got here, here's the way it used to be. I would come occasionally onto some radio or television program, and the interviewer, the announcer, the host would begin by saying, "Hello, ladies and gentlemen, today I have," pregnant pause, "one of those." And then they would proceed to describe me in a way that would make my mother nervous. And as soon as they were finished with this description of the very strange person they had invited, the next step in the interview saw the host patting himself or herself on the back for having the enormously broad-minded openness to have one of them on the program. You know, if you're introduced that way, it's over almost before you begin. What's left to be said? All that has changed. Now I'm on the radio and the television, and I'm Professor Wolff. I should tell you, I was Professor Wolff last year, too. And 10 years ago, I was, that's all I've ever done, has been a professor of economics, basically. But now I'm the professor, and now I have something interesting to say, and now we it's a complete new world. It took me a while to understand that I wasn't in the combative place I had become used to. There's a lot of talk in the United States about the Tea Parties and the movement to the right. What there isn't so much recognition of, but what my life is proof of, is that there's been a sea change on the left, opening spaces for people like us to talk, to have an audience that is qualitatively unlike anything I've seen in my lifetime. And I was born in Youngstown, Ohio, if any of you know about that place. I've lived all my life in the United States, and this is a whole new world for me, and you should take some comfort, I think, from that. Okay, so let's go back. I described to you an economic crisis in full rush ahead, in which the mass of people continues to suffer under a set of circumstances that are very severe and that are not changing, while the rich are in fact literally getting richer relative to the rest of us with each week or month's statistics. Keep all that in mind when we take a small historical detour. I want to contrast for you what's happening now, or rather what isn't happening now, with what did once happen the last time the United States found itself in an economic crisis on this scale. That's the 1930s. A great crisis begins in October of 1929. Over the first 3 or 4 years, from 29 to 1933-34, the situation gets worse and worse and worse. Massive unemployment. Massive suffering. But then something happens in 1933 and 4 that radically alters everything. And that's what we need to think about. First, something happened which didn't radically alter much. The election of a very centrist Democrat, sort of like an Obama, except of course he wasn't black, Franklin Roosevelt, came in on a balanced budget program, last thing on earth that was needed. And he becomes the president. That wasn't the important event. Here was the important event. Three institutions had begun to mobilize already earlier, but they really took off in the Great Depression. The first was a union organizing drive, bigger and more successful than any union organizing drive that had ever happened in American history before, or that has ever happened since. It was called the Congress of Industrial Organizations, the CIO, for those of you who know about the AFL-CIO. The CIO part took off, and it organized tens of millions of Americans in a matter of months. Amazing, powerful. The basic industries, chemicals, automobiles, electric workers, and so on. The second thing, some of you that are older will know this from your memories, was that we had strong, growing, vibrant, and powerful socialist and communist parties in the United States. And they mobilized, and they had large numbers of members. And in case you're wondering, yes, there was quite a bit of overlap between the CIO, the socialists, and the communists, all kinds. And they were a powerful group. And they basically went to the government and they said, this is a capitalism that isn't working for the mass of people, and we are going to fight. You better do something. And if you don't, we're going to stop this society from functioning until you do. And they meant it. And the government knew that they meant it. This gave the new president a choice to make. Are you going to try to repress this when it's big and powerful and on a scale that the country had never seen before, a real movement? Or are you going to try to work out a deal? And for better or worse, Roosevelt made the latter decision. He cut a deal. And here's how the deal went. I will give you, talking to the unions and the socialists and the communists, he met with them, by the way, I will give you a tremendous boost. I'm going to legalize you. I'm going to make you legitimate in the United States. And I'm going to give the masses of people enormous help in this crisis. And I'm going to give you the credit for having gotten that. In exchange, don't mess with capitalism. Leave it alone. I'll take care of you. What did Roosevelt mean by this? And here's the lesson for us now. What Roosevelt meant was, I'm going to find the money. Let me remind you, today you hear there's not enough money for this, there's not enough money for that. San Rafael can't have enough money, and San Francisco doesn't have enough money, and Obama doesn't have enough money. We can't do this, we have to cut back that. The Great Depression, the unemployment was 25% in 1933. That's 2.5 times what it is now. So they had a much more severe problem of no money. What did the new president, when he cut a deal, what did he provide for the mass of people? He found the money. And I'm going to tell you in a few minutes just how he did it. But first, I want you to see what he did. Number one, he created, in the midst of the Great Depression, the Social Security system. We didn't have that before. I'm not going to ask anyone to raise their hand about when they knew the Social Security system started. This is not a history class. But just in case, it started in the middle of the 30s. Suddenly, in a Great Depression, when there's no money, the president announces that if you're 65 years of age or older and have done a lifetime of work, the government's now going to give you money forever until you die. What? There's no money. Yes, there is. We're going to take care of the old people. And we're going to say to all the young people, you don't have to take care of your older relatives the way you thought you would have to with no money because it's an unemployment situation. We'll do it. Wow. That was only the beginning. Next, he said, I'm going to create, for the first time in American history, an unemployment insurance program. We didn't have that before in this country either. If you're unemployed, which millions of Americans were, I got news for you. I'm going to give you money, lots of it, every week, for doing nothing. Just because you're unemployed. What? What? Yes. But those were the small programs. Here comes the big one. In 1934, Roosevelt goes on the radio, and he says just about these words. If the private economic system, if private enterprises either cannot or will not give jobs to millions of Americans who want to work and are capable to work, then there's no alternative but for the government to give the work to the... Whoops. No censorship. No censorship. This is my own mistake. At least not yet. We'll see. Maybe as the talk wears on, get better. So Roosevelt says, if the private sector cannot, then the public sector must. Between 1934 and 1941, Roosevelt created and filled 12 million federal jobs. He found the money to pay all those people a living salary. Let's see. There was no money in the Great Depression. And with no money in the middle of the 1930s, he created Social Security, unemployment insurance, and he hired 12 million people. Where did the money come from? Here comes the other part of the deal. Roosevelt went to the wealthy, the business leaders of America. And after all, the Roosevelt family was part of that. He came from those people. And he said to them, I have to take care of the mass of people because if I don't, the system is over. If you don't deal with me, down the road are those unions and socialists and communists, and they're going to cut you a much worse deal. So I suggest you give me the money to produce for the mass of people to keep the lid on this explosive situation. And he split the business community and the wealthy right down the middle. Half of them bought his argument. The other half of them, and don't forget that other half, we're going to come back to them, they never did. They didn't like Roosevelt. They fought him every step of the way. But half of them went along. And so here's what Roosevelt did. He taxed them big time. He taxed the rich people and he taxed the corporations. And he used the money for all the things I just described. And the unions and the socialists and the communists gave him what he wanted. They thanked him. They celebrated him as the great savior, literally in that kind of language. They didn't question the capitalist system anymore. Even those who called themselves communists didn't do that. He was the great victor, the great leader. And in case you're interested in politics, Roosevelt's deal, splitting the rich, making them pay, and creating massive programs to help the people, made Franklin Roosevelt the most successful president the United States has ever had, reelected four times. The only reason there's a law on the books now that limits presidents to two sessions is the Republicans were so freaked out by Roosevelt that they got a law passed so that nobody could do that again. But the next time you hear someone tell you it's politically not a good idea to try to push a program to help the average person, remind them a little bit of our own history as a nation. That was the ticket to a successful president in a way nothing Mr. Obama has yet done could come close to. One would have to wonder why Mr. Obama doesn't try that if he's worried about next year. What were the rich required to pay? Again, I don't have all the time, but a couple of the numbers may blow your mind if you're not familiar with it. Under Roosevelt, taxes on rich people were raised. How high? In the 1940s and 50s, the following. The richest taxpayers in America, the richest individuals, had to pay on every dollar roughly over $75,000, the top bracket if you got that much, and that was a lot more then than it would be now, obviously. The top rate, 91%. Let me explain what that means. For every dollar over $75,000 you earned, you sent Uncle Sam 91 cents, you kept nine. That was the tax rate not only put through by Roosevelt with the Congress's approval, but it was endorsed and kept in the 40s, the 50s, and the 60s by Republicans and Democratic presidents alike and by Republican and Democratic Congresses alike. Taxing rich people at a high rate, being un-American, you don't know your history. It's as American as apple pie and baseball. Better. Taxes on corporations in 1945, for every dollar raised by the federal government in taxing individuals, it got $1.50 in taxing corporations. 50% more of the government's revenue came from taxing corporations than individuals. What is the relationship today? For every dollar the federal government gets from individuals today, it gets from business 25 cents. That's the reality. And what's the top income bracket on the richest people? Is it the 91% of the 50s and 60s? No, it's 35%. Those are the tax cuts of the last 50 years. Removing the burden of taxation on corporations and shifting it to individuals, step one. Step two, removing the burden of taxation from the richest individuals and putting it instead on all of you. So on behalf of America's corporations and its rich, I want to say to all of you, thank you. You have been very kind. But of course, the reality is different. And here comes the punchline for today's talk. That part of the business community that didn't like the deal that Roosevelt had struck, didn't want to be taxed, didn't want to pay taxes, neither as corporations nor as individuals. They said, okay, Roosevelt got this one, but as soon as this depression is over, as soon as the war, which is what finally ended it, is over, we're gonna fight to get rid of everything that was done by Roosevelt. We don't like that kind of capitalism. We won't tolerate it. And here's what they did in the last 40 to 50 years. They used their position as the leaders of America's corporations. They used their position as the boards of directors of the corporations, gathering into their hands the profits of all enterprises. They used that money and those positions to undo everything Roosevelt did. That's why the tax rates are 35% today for the top, not 91%. That's why corporations have basically gotten out of paying much in the way of income taxes. Some of you notice that every year there's a little story in the press once or twice telling us about how GE or GM paid no taxes at all last year, given the various loopholes and other things that they had the money to write into the law over the last 50 years. Even the efforts of the Roosevelt government to regulate the American business community were undone. The most famous example, in the depths of the Depression, when banks had gone completely belly up, just like they did this time, the government passed a law, Banking Act of 1933, sometimes referred to by the name Glass-Steagall, because that was the name of the two legislators who pushed it through Congress. All it did was say that any bank that accepts deposits, the sort that you and I put in, cannot take inordinate risks with them. They can't invest that money long term because that risks them being unable to give you back the deposits you put in there. Or in the language of economics, they separated depository banking from investment banking. Those banks went right to work as soon as that law was passed to undo it. And they worked. It took a while. People had a memory of the Great Depression. They didn't trust banks too well. So they had to take a lot of time. They had to buy a lot of politicians. But being corporate presidents and heads of big banks, they had the resources to buy the politicians. And so by 1990, it was possible to pass a law undoing the Glass-Steagall Act. And in 1999, then President Bill Clinton signed the bill that undid the separation of investment banking and deposit banking. And 8 years later, the banking system collapsed again. What is the lesson of all of this? Two lessons that I want to drive home, because they point to what we as a movement need to do. First, regulating an economy, trying to use one or another regulation to deal with these crises, doesn't work. We have just been through a phase of our history in which the regulations that were passed were systematically undone. And in case you don't keep up, it's not just that the tax on corporations has dropped. It's not just that the tax on the rich has dropped. It's not just that the banking laws were changed again to allow the same abuse again that produced another crisis again. They are now tampering with something no one thought for the last 50 years they could tamper with, Social Security. It'll likely be this coming year, or if not then, for sure the next one, that are the age at which people can become eligible for Social Security will be raised in the United States, 2 or more years. Those plans are already there. They're discussed openly in Washington. It's a crazy idea. It's unfair to the people who put their money in there for all those years. But at a time of unemployment, what of course does it mean? Instead of people being able to retire at 65 with a government pension they've counted on for 40 years, thereby opening that job to a young person or an unemployed person who needs it, we are now going to keep people in the labor force longer, which means our unemployment will last longer as well. Crazy, crazy stuff. But it's the stuff of a system that works this way. If we don't learn the lesson, and if we repeat again that we're going to regulate this system so it doesn't bite us in the rear end as regularly as it always has, then we haven't learned anything. This last time when the New Deal regulations were undone, we can say shame on those corporations for doing it. But if all we do in the face of this crisis is do it all again, then it's shame on us for not having learned the lesson that that wasn't enough. What is the positive lesson? We can't allow it to happen again. We cannot. We cannot allow this to continue. Whether it's the damage to Mexico, the damage to Detroit, the damage to young people who can't get a job, at least not one that they've been trained and educated to expect and to know how to do. But our commitment to a society and to a future is crucial here. What's the lesson that has to be learned? And here I have to push a little bit, even the boundaries of what you may be comfortable thinking about, but there really is no way out. If we're going to make an economic system that works for us, that does not periodically subject us to the kinds of crisis of the Great Depression, and remember how I began, I said we're in the fifth year. How long did the Great Depression last? 1929, 1941. That's a lot more than 5 years. And in case you think long depressions are only a thing of the distant past, In 1989, the second most important capitalist country collapsed into depression, Japan. And they're still in it. They never got out. The idea this is going to be a short one. Remember when this began in 2007 and 8? George Bush was president, saying, no problem, we'll be out of this quicker. This is not, no problem. Early years of Obama, no problem, we're going to have this solved, no problem. What? They don't even dare say that anymore. Too many times, it didn't work. So what is it we have to do? What's the lesson? And here I have to say something that is particularly appropriate because we're standing in front of the name over there, Arizmendi Bakery. Arizmendi, let's talk a little bit about that as the lesson. Arizmendi was a Spanish priest in the north of Spain, right near the French border, the Pyrenees Mountains, Basque territory, the Basque people, suffering unbelievable unemployment. In the same period of time, Great Depression, World War II. And he knew that he could not rely on the capitalist enterprise system, corporations, board of directors, shareholders, to provide work for his desperate people, so he took another step. Being a Catholic priest, he had a lot of authority in Spanish culture and society, and he set up worker-directed, worker-run, worker-owned enterprises. Not working people dependent on a board of directors or shareholders, working people using their own little savings, their own labor, to set up and operate their own businesses. Over 50 years ago. Today, the number of people who participate in what is there called the Mondragon system, founded by, I believe his name was Luis or Jose, I'm not sure, Arizmendi, now numbers 100,000 workers, the most successful cooperative, collective enterprise system in modern history. It's worth something to think about, not just because it's romantic or clever or sounds good. Those are all perfectly adequate reasons, but here's the one I want you to think about. If you don't want, if we don't want this economic system to continue to impose these kinds of devastating long-term crises. And remember, the unemployed, as every medical statistic shows, when you have unemployed like this, you are damaging not just the worker who loses his or her job, but his or her spouse and his or her children, and the impact on schooling and on mental health and on physical health and on alcoholism. It's endless, the costs of these crises. They last for decades. They make a mockery of the claim that this is an economic system that has anything to do with efficiency? You must be kidding. This isn't efficient. This is whatever the opposite of that is. So here's the lesson. You can't have reforms because the reforms get undone. Let's remember what a capitalist corporation is. It is run in this country, and in most countries, by something called a board of directors. 12 to 15 people, on average, who make all the basic decisions. What to produce, how to produce, where to produce, and what to do with the profits. And they're responsible to the people who put them in that job, the board of directors. And who are they? The major shareholders, not the shareholders as a whole, that's again your grandma with the 11 shares of something she left you. The major shareholders, we call them. And those, by the way, in most corporations are 15 to 20 other people. 15 to 20 major shareholders talking with the 15 to 20 people they put on the board of directors. They make all the decisions. For them, high taxes is a problem to be solved. For them, regulations impede the profitability of their enterprise, another problem to be solved. So here's what the boards of directors and the major shareholders do. They direct their underlings, their economists, like me, their accountants, their lawyers, you know, to solve the problem. If there's a law that's hurting profits, evade it. If you can, amend it. And if you're really powerful, obliterate it, repeal it, get rid of it, like they did with the Glass-Steagall Act, like they did with high tax rates on corporations, like they did, et cetera, et cetera. If you leave them in the positions they were left in by the CIO, the socialists, and the communists, then they will undo whatever you've been able to win as fast as they know how. If all we do now is come up with some new regulations, the Dodd-Frank Act, or some new rules, or some new temporary taxes on rich people, you know, you really already know, you don't need me to know, that they have the wherewithal, as long as they run the businesses of this society, to take it away. The only difference will be over the next few years, they'll do it faster because they've had the last 50 years of practice and they've gotten really good at it. And you know that. They got smart. They didn't use Pinkertons and goons. Well, let me change that. They didn't use only Pinkertons and goons. They had the sophisticated forms, the think tanks, to issue endless reports, to fill the mailboxes of all the legislators with this or that rule. But most important, what the corporations knew was that they had the wealth in their hands and they could go to the political system and make sure it worked for them. They made sure it worked for them. Whether it's the think tank that changes the public's awareness of a problem, whether it's buying a particular politician or funding a particular party. If you've noticed over your lifetime that the difference between Republicans and Democrats is getting harder and harder to see, even if they wear different colored shirts, it's because they are beholden to the same fundamental source. And let's be clear, if you're going to undo the Great Depression's reforms, if you're going to negate the New Deal, if you're going to make a society of extreme wealth and poverty, if you're one of the rich 1%, you couldn't be so stupid as to imagine you can afford not to control the political system. If that's your strategy, if that's your goal, you better control the political system or else it isn't secure. So they did. If you're going to change all of this, then it isn't enough to find occasionally the decent politician who says, I'm not going to play that game. I'm not going to subordinate myself to money. And it is very rare that I have the opportunity, but I'm going to take it right now, to say that there is in this area, I've been taught, and I've been informed, and I'm glad to mention it, somebody who I believe is here. Over there, Norman Solomon, who is pledged not to take corporate donations, is pledged not to participate. That is an amazing and unspeakably rare phenomenon in our culture. And much as I am dubious, to say the least, about our two-party system and what they offer us, when someone comes along who tries to change it from the inside, that person deserves the support that even those of us who are skeptical can give him. So I'm glad to say that on behalf of Norman. But the solution goes far beyond that, and I'm sure Norman would agree. The solution is, and here comes Arismendi, we cannot leave the business of the American economy in the hands of capitalist corporations. If we do, we will have this not just in the 1930s, not just in the beginning of this new century, we will bequeath the same risks and the same catastrophes to our children and our grandchildren. We have to learn the lesson. And the lesson is this. We have to go further than the CIO, the socialists, and the communists were able or willing to go in the 1930s. We cannot make changes and leave in place the institutions that will undo them, because that's how they're organized. That's what they do. That's what they're paid to do. What do I mean? We have to ask finally with courage, and I think with enormous support that the American people will give to this. Certainly been my experience as I talk all over the country about it. We have to bite the bullet. We have to say that the corporations of the United States are too important for the well-being of the mass of the people to continue to be held in the hands of a tiny group of people that not only clashes with the kind of economic well-being and security we need as a people, but it clashes with the most fundamental conception of democracy that exists. You know, as a nation, we're supposed to be advocates and enthusiasts for democracy. Democracy means that those who have to live with a decision must therefore participate in making it. We do not allow political decisions about our communities to be made by people who have no responsibility to us, who have to live with them. And yet, when you go to work every day, to your factory, to your office, to your store, you walk into a place in which the decisions what to produce, how to produce, where to produce, and what to do with the fruits of your labor are made by somebody else who has no responsibility to you in reaching those decisions whatsoever. If democracy is valuable, how in the world did we come to be in a society which doesn't make them valuable and applicable in the place we spend most of our adult lives? 5 out of 7 days, 9 to 5, you're at work. That's where your lifetime as an adult is mostly spent. If democracy is a value, it would have to apply there. By what rule was it excluded at the front door? And let me drive home in conclusion where this leads. Imagine that the workers in the enterprises of America ran the businesses themselves. Here's how it might look. Monday to Thursday, you come to work like you always did, and you do your particular task, whatever that is. On Friday, you come to work like you always did, but you don't do your particular task. You sit around all day with all the other workers, and you debate, and you discuss, and you decide collectively, democratically, by vote, what to produce, how to produce, where to produce, and what to do with the profits. Here are some interesting things that might then happen. Let's see. Let's start with the following question. Should we close the factory and reopen in China? No, we're not going to do that, because that's us. That's our job, that's our community, that's our school system, we're not going to do that. Here's another thought. In the United States, unlike most other capitalist countries, they pay the top executives in these large corporations something that averages around 300 to 350 times the average salary of a worker in that enterprise. That's what it is. Most other capitalist countries don't do that, anywhere near that big, much smaller in places like Germany, Japan, and so on. Guess what wouldn't happen if the workers collectively ran their own enterprises? They wouldn't pay the executives, even if they had them, 300 times what the average worker, not even close. And guess what? That would be the single biggest blow to reducing the inequality of wealth and income in the United States that one could imagine. Because average people, whatever they might do in the way of paying some people a bit more than others for all kinds of reasons, are not going to do the obscenity that has become the norm in the United States. Here's another example. If a board of directors sitting in Chicago decides it's more profitable to use a toxic chemical in a factory here in California, they're free to do that. Do you think the same decision would be made if the workers in each enterprise made the decision themselves what technologies to use? I don't think so, because they have to breathe that. And their children who live nearby have to breathe that. And the community of which they're a part has to breathe it or use it as water, etc. So those of us that are concerned about ecological issues, here too is a basis for an alliance. It's democratic, it's more ecologically sensitive and friendly. It does takes a major step in the direction of less inequality in wealth and income. How many more virtues do I have to list? This is a long overdue change in America. And if the workers themselves decided what to do with the profits, they wouldn't undo social welfare programs that were passed by the government in the manner of the Great New Deal. They would see those as valuable supports for what they want for themselves, their children, and their communities. It is long overdue that we question the traditional capitalist system. I don't want to shy away from what I'm suggesting, because I'm confident. And I wouldn't be so confident, and I didn't used to be so confident. But as I slowly moved in the direction of saying these things, instead of seeing audiences that got more and more uncomfortable, which is what I was used to, I found audiences that got more and more excited. Over the last 50 years, this country, on the question of capitalism, has been in hibernation. You know, over the last 50 years, we as a nation have taken a certain amount of pride, and I think it's deserved, that we question, for example, our educational system. Are our schools working? If not, they go, we should debate this or that. We just came off a year and a half ago debating our national health system and our health delivery and insurance systems. And we debate our transportation system, and we debate our water system. We debate the systems and institutions we live with and depend on. But here is now a taboo. For the last 50 years, you could not debate our economic system. To dare to do that was to be called, dare I say it, a red, a commie, or whatever. Everybody had to wave the flag. No debate, no discussion. Why? The economic system doesn't deserve dispute, debate, and change. It can't be improved. Come on, you know better. Everybody knows better. Finally, and in this you have played already a major part. The Occupy movement is the first movement in 50 years to put the economic question right up front, right from the beginning. And that is an enormous contribution. In that way, you are ending a 50-year taboo in this culture. And because the capitalist system, the economic system, was protected behind the taboo of no criticism, it did what always happens to institutions that are not criticized. It rots. It falls apart. It disserves the people who live in it. So you're doing something for the American people, even those that are irritated by you. You're doing them an enormous service. You're taking an institution that isn't working, and you're saying it's up for debate. It can be questioned, it should be questioned. In any healthy society, it would have been questioned for all 50 years. But okay, that history is over. At the very least, we can start anew and begin by saying there's no reason, none, neither in their performance nor in its relationship to democracy, for an economic system to continue that locates all the basic decisions in a tiny group of unaccountable people. So let me conclude by urging you to stay with this movement that you are part of, that you helped to begin, not to be distressed if the fickle media come and pay you a lot of attention for a while and then find something else to focus on. That's what it means when a media is not driven by the objective newsworthiness of a topic, but is driven by the same profit calculations that we have come to see as a problem in this society. The media are part of that. A little statistic for some of you might enjoy. In 1983, 90% of American media were controlled by 50 corporations, 50. Today, 90% of American media are controlled by 6 corporations. And you know their names, Viacom, Disney, and a few others. They control it all. And they are driven by the same profit mentality. They're making the same decisions on the same basis. That is the problem. We are grown-ups. Capitalism is not something handed down as part of the tablets Moses gave us. Capitalism is a system that was born, that flourished, and like every other system, it will die. The question is only how many of us it will take with us, with it. And we have the time, and at least so far in this society, we have the space, the political freedom still, to have meetings like this and to allow folks like me to travel all across the country talking about this to audiences much larger than we've ever seen in the United States before. Occupy the United States, occupy Wall Street, occupy the corporation are the watchwords that are developing on a new left in the United States. Not a new left that emerges from one particular corner of the society, but something that comes organically out of a society that has reached a self-recognition of its problems. It's important. You are pioneers of a new sort. Hang in there. Everybody will applaud sooner than you think. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I'm now going to read and try quickly to respond to questions that some of you have written on these cards. First question, is there any chance for a new deal in Obama's second term? Well, if nothing changes from the basic conditions of the first term, I would have to say not much of a chance. But the answer is also now in play because of you. If Occupy grows, if it develops, well, all bets are off. I can assure you, because of my Ivy League background and my personal friends, many of whom work in Washington, that the Occupy movement has been very much on the minds of the highest levels of the United States government pretty much since it began. There was the hope, and I assure you of this as well, there was the hope that the Obama administration could make use of the Occupy movement. They certainly thought so. They were aware, as they still are, that they cannot get out the army of volunteers anything like what they did in 2008, and they're going to lack that. And they thought in the early weeks of Occupy Wall Street that this would be the new constituency that could be brought around to line up under Obama. Mrs. Pelosi's staff from around here went to New York City to Zuccotti Park to talk to people about that. And her people were told politely, no chance. We don't feel that that's what we want to do as a movement. And so they went back to what they didn't get that. But it shows you what they were thinking, and it shows you what they need. Second, the conditions of the American economy that produced, among other things, Occupy Wall Street, and that have produced the difficulties for Mr. Obama, are not going away. The American economy shows no, there's nothing on the horizon that any economist can see. I'm not talking about left-wingers like me. I sit down in New York City where I live with middle-of-the-road and right-wing economists all the time. We disagree on many things. But on the question of the American economy, we all sit there over lunch, shake our heads and say, oh my God, this is the worst we've ever seen. We have no idea what's going to happen. The American economy, which is in very shaky condition, depends, for example, on Europe. The European economy is in deep trouble, so we don't know what that's going to mean. The Chinese, upon whom we depend in fundamental ways, are in their own set of difficulties. We don't know where that's going to go. I mean, the level of uncertainty is staggering and means no one knows where things are going. But the one thing we're all clear on is no fundamental solution to the depressed conditions of the American economy anytime soon. Next question. Is there going to be, same question, economic upturn? Eventually, but no one knows how big it'll be, when it'll happen, how long it'll last. You know, we're in a long-term economic decline. It's very important that everyone here understand that. It's not just about this crisis. Real wages, remember I mentioned to you at the beginning, real wage, the amount of wages a person gets per hour, adjusted for the prices he or she has to pay. Real wages in the United States today, 2012, are roughly what they were in 1978. It's very important that Americans understand that what you get paid, what your employer gives you per hour, in terms of what you can buy with it, is no greater now than it was 35 years ago. What did the American working people do over the last 35 years? And remember, as some of you have read my book, you know, the remarkable thing about the United States was what we as a history had. From the 1820s to 1970, real wages went up every decade in the United States. We were the land which experienced something no other capitalist country ever had. 150 years of rising wages enabling our workers to enjoy a rising standard of living, which is why a large number of people came to this country to get something here that they didn't think they would get at home. And they were right. And into this culture, we settled into this idea, which I guess some of us still have, that there's something absolutely charmed about the United States. If you're a religious person, then God, he, she, it, whatever, must really like us. Because we had this rising standard of living based on the rising wages, and therefore every American knew that his children would live better than he, and the grandchildren still better, and if you work real hard, you'll do real well, and you'll live in a house, and have a dog, and a station wagon, and have a vacation. Try to imagine, because it's our own history, what it means in the 1970s when that history stops and never resumes. My wife is a psychotherapist. She explained to me that the reaction of the American people to that is called trauma. It's the end. And one of the things that makes a trauma worse, she explained to me, is if you cannot discuss what's happening to you, which we as a nation couldn't do. Nobody in this culture in the 70s or the 80s or the 90s or even today talks about what it means to a society that ends a rising wage history of 150 years. So American people solved the problem themselves. As individuals, a little lesson for you. If you try to solve a social problem as an individual, you're going to be a very unhappy person, because you can't do that. To solve a social problem, you need a social movement. But Americans didn't recognize they had a social problem. They thought it was their personal fault. My wages aren't going up anymore. Must be something wrong with me. So they did two things to deal with the upset. One, They did more work, you know, if you don't get any more per hour, do more hours. Here's a statistic to think about. According to the OECD, one of the world's most important data gathering institutions, Americans do more hours of paid labor per year than any other population on the planet. So if you feel tired, you should. You are working your ass off. Some of you go to Europe and you like to visit France and Italy and you enjoy, gee, these people know how to live. They start dinner at 5 and they have an aperitif and some olives and then they sit down and they talk. Of course they do. They have time. The average work week is 20%, one-fifth of the week less than you. 20% less is the work week in Germany and Italy compared to the United States. By the way, Germany's doing really well during this crisis, not like us. The second thing the American people did, you all know it, since the 1970s, when it turned out that doing more hours wasn't enough. And it wasn't, by the way, just more hours for one person. It was, of course, the great migration of American adult women out of the household into the workplace. All that work. Turns out, of course, that the woman has to go to work. She can't live the way she did before. She needs another set of clothes. The family needs another car. So the Americans did that other thing. They borrowed money. We became a pioneer population again. Only this time the pioneer was, we borrowed more money than any working class in the history of the world had ever borrowed before. They had to develop in the 1970s whole new ways for Americans to borrow. Up until then we had just borrowed, you know, on the house, a mortgage, and maybe a little layaway plan at the store. But they developed that new thing. That plastic thing that you have in your wallet, the credit card. And I notice in San Francisco, where I've been the last few days, that I can stick my credit card into the parking meter and so spend $3 for an hour in the corner by using plastic debt. So by 2007, what did we have? We had an American working class physically exhausted by all the labor, psychologically stressed because the women who held the family together were now as tired as their husbands and couldn't do it. And the family is falling apart. If you go back and look at old television in the 1970s, the typical family on the sitcom was the Nelsons. The daddy who goes to work with a tie and a briefcase, and mama who's at home with the children, the dog, and the kitchen, and everybody's just ducky happy. And what is the sitcom today? The dysfunctional family. The husband and wife who haven't slept together for so long, they don't remember what it is. We celebrate what we are. And also in 2007, we reached the limit of debt. The Americans can't hold the debt anymore. That's why they can't get us out of this depression, because you can't borrow anymore. Nobody will lend to you. That's the mistake the banks made last time. We're done. We've postponed the confrontation with the 1970s for 35 years. There's nothing left to postpone. We are now facing the problem that we stalled for 30 years by too much work, by dissolving the family, and by borrowing money. The only thing worse than that is to understand the politics of dissolving the family. The Republicans and the Democrats served business by freezing the wages, preventing them from going up, and driving the women out. But the genius of the Republican Party was to recognize that in the destruction of the family, they could make political hay. They became the party that champions family values. The thing they had helped destroy, they would bring back by abolishing abortion and celebrating the church and bringing us back. They made a political gain out of what the Democrats still don't understand as the crisis of the system they endorse. What's the future of the young people who cannot afford high tuitions for new for their education. Well, I wish I had good news for you on this, but I don't. Here's the story in higher education, colleges and universities, to keep in mind the basic reality. Roughly 15 million people in the United States go to college and university, 15. Out of that, 3 million, roughly, go to private schools. 12 million go to public schools. It's important to understand that higher education in the United States is a public enterprise, not a private enterprise in the main. Also in our society, it is the state governments that pay for higher education by and large, the 50 states. Every one of the 50 states is cutting the money for higher education. Everyone. I noticed yesterday that your governor here in California is announcing a budget that will also cut 400 or 500 million, at least at this point, from the education system, higher education system. Okay, what does this mean? It means you live in a society that has a fundamental irrationality. Every economist, left, right, and center, will tell you that the United States is now part of a world economy, and that the future of the United States and the world economy depends as much as it depends on anything, on the quality, the training, the skill of the young people who are trained in our public institutions of higher learning. Okay, that means that our future depends on that which we are currently cutting. If that strikes you as ridiculous, crazy, self-destructive, shooting yourself in the foot, you've understood. And if you assume that the United States is a reasonable country with intelligent people, as it is and as I do, then you have to ask the question, why would a society, otherwise reasonable, be busily cutting the institution upon which its economic future depends? That's because the wealthy don't want to pay the taxes, the government doesn't have the money, it has to cut somewhere, so it cuts. It cuts education. In the field of economics, one further indication of how bad it is. We can no longer, the universities where I work, we can no longer say to our graduate students as we used to, if you come here and you get your PhD, we will get you a job teaching in an American college or university. That's over. The vast majority of jobs in public higher education now, and increasingly in private higher education, is not what it was. It's not a professor who teaches two or three courses a semester, gets tenure and all that. It is what is called in most parts of the country an adjunct. This is a part-time teacher who teaches two or three courses, is paid by the course, and therefore costs the university a small fraction of what a traditional professor would have received. This is profitable for the university. It is a cost-cutting measure, but it means that your teacher is an underpaid, harried person who teaches two courses here, three courses over there, another course over there, and rushes between them, has not the time to talk to you, not the time to keep up with the literature, and not the time to be a very good professor, unless he or she is a saint, and there aren't many of those. Higher education is being downsized, cut back, and deteriorated. And there is no end in sight. That's what Governor Brown meant when he announced that he's going to cut another several hundred million dollars from the higher education system. What's actually being done, although you don't see that unless you are a professor, is inside each university, little enclaves are created that are favored, while many departments are cut back, forced to rely on adjuncts, and all the rest of it. Very, very dangerous, and a sign of a society out of control if it tries to solve the short-term problem of a crisis by cutting back its future in terms of training. What do you think about North Dakota's banking system? Good question. North Dakota is a society which, for all kinds of strange reasons, set up years and years ago a public bank. It does not rely on private banks the way most states like California and New York do. And the public bank of North Dakota came through this crisis with no crisis at all. Did much, much better than most American banks because it was very carefully run, because all of its decisions had to be made transparent because they're publicly owned and they're publicly responsible both to the media and to the political authorities of the state. And so it's a model for an alternative kind of banking. Let me take this moment to explain also to you the peculiarity of the United States. As I said to you earlier in my talk, if someone could get that, thank you. As I said to you earlier in my talk, the Federal Reserve and the United States government bailed out the American banking system to the tune of trillions of dollars. It is interesting in our society that no one, with the exception of a tiny number of political people, had the courage to say a banking system that completely breaks down twice in 75 years, the 1930s and again 2008-09, and that requires massive amounts of government help, risking the money of all of us, is a system that has demonstrated it is not a reliable way to handle finances. And therefore, the conclusion should be that we render finance public. It becomes a public obligation. It's a little bit like understanding that we don't allow the police and the fire departments in our communities to be private. If you have a fire in your house, you do not worry whether you are going to call company A or company B and worry about which one is the one to call. You have a fire department because the idea is it's too important to be left to individual decisions. Because after all, if my neighbor chooses to hire no fire company or to hire a lousy one, then the fire at my neighbor's home could become the fire at my home. It's a social problem, and so it's dealt with as a social phenomena. So we don't have private fire companies. We have a public fire department. And the same with the police, and the same with the military security, and the same with public parks. Well, here's a no-brainer. If a private banking system collapses with such calamity repeatedly, what in the world are we doing with it? Why is there no debate in the United States about the virtues and costs of a public versus a private banking system? And by the way, in case you're wondering, our European counterparts have in fact utilized repeatedly in modern times public banking system. After World War II, all the major banks in France were nationalized. They were public institutions. And they were run for many, many decades as public institutions, and they did fine. France didn't collapse, France didn't disappear, they still make the best food on the planet, etc., etc. It's in this country's craziness over time, the refusal to question private capitalism, that leads to these strange results when the colossal failure doesn't permit anyone to say, well, what are we doing with a private banking system that works this way? And when we saw in 2009 and 10 that the banks bailed out by the federal government with your money were using the money to lobby your representatives to make sure they weren't overregulated, you got to scratch your head and wonder, you know, if the world is upside down. No, it isn't upside down. It's a society that has a taboo on private corporate enterprise. How could we make public control of our accumulated capital? Well, there are some words it's still difficult to say in public. So I'll leave it to your imagination. If the corporations should not function the way they do now, should not be organized the way they are now, then there has to be a public movement that pushes in that direction. And again, we are not starting from scratch. Let me tell you about Germany. In a way, Germany is an important example because it is the country most like ours in Europe, economically speaking. It is now the center of the new European United States of Europe, in effect. It is the most powerful economy in Europe by far, and will be the leader of whatever happens in Europe, win, lose, or draw, in the years ahead. Germany has a number of, and by the way, Germany's unemployment has been dropping across this crisis. Germany's unemployment now is half what it is in the United States.
They're also ending nuclear power.
Their leader was forced, very interesting for those of you that are interested, when the Fukushima disaster happened in Japan, the German Green Movement rose up and made it an issue inside Germany. So well did they do that, so massive was the German support, that the leader of Germany, Mrs. Angela Merkel is her name, the chancellor, reversed her commitment to nuclear policy and announced the closing of every single nuclear power establishment in Germany, and that is happening. She didn't do that out of conviction. She did that because the last three by-elections in Germany, her party lost, and the Green Party in Germany zoomed up on the grounds of that perspective. But what I want to stress about Germany is some lessons, in case you don't know this. In Germany, if a plant wants to leave, to close down, to open somewhere else in the world, they have to give a year's notice. We have nothing like that in the United States. A year's notice. They have to get the approval of the trade union and the local community. And if they don't get it, they can't leave. My goodness. What an idea. Here's another one. If you have more than 2,000 employees, more than 2,000 employees, one half of your board of directors must be workers elected from the workforce. That's the law in Germany. Now, that hasn't been a solution, because the boards can still keep the power in the group that is not the workers, so that the workers have a subordinate position on the board of directors. But it's a step. And that law was passed, and the German corporate community was opposed to it. They were defeated. They were defeated. They were defeated by a combination of two political parties in Germany. The old Socialist Party, which is still the second biggest party in Germany. But the one that really took it over in the last 8 or 9 years that has changed German politics is something else you might want to think about. There's a new political party in Germany, and it's called, just in case you were wondering what its position is, it's called in German Die Linke, which is German for the left. That's a clue. It's called the left. In the last German election, in the autumn of 2010, the last German national election, the left party got 11.9% of the national vote. 1 in 8 Germans voted for a party whose slogan is, Germany can do better than capitalism. Now, I know for historical reasons, I would be the last one to suggest that we take a page from the Germans in terms of what we're going to do, but it is something to think about, that in Germany, with a powerful left party, all kinds of things get done that can't get done elsewhere. There's another lesson about America that we could take as a way to move forward on these issues of changing the way corporations work by using our political power. Europe, almost every country in Europe, no, I take that back. Every country in Europe has something called proportional representation. It's a simple idea. Here's how it goes. If you get X percent of the vote in an election, you must get X percent of the seats in the parliament or the representative body that these elections were for. So if you get 12% of the vote, the way the Die Linke party did in Germany, you get 12% of the seats in parliament. You become a political force. Here in the United States, we don't do that. If you win, you get it all, and if you don't, you get 49%, you get nothing. It effectively excludes all the parties that would otherwise not only get a large vote, but then be part of the law-writing procedure. That would change dramatically what happens here in the United States if we could do that. And by the way, again for your history, there have been parts of the United States that had that. In the 1940s in New York City, the elections for the City Council of New York that governs the city was done by proportional representation. As a result, the Communist Party in New York City ran a candidate for City Council whose name was Benjamin Davis. An African American, a black man, ran for the City Council of New York in 1948, I think, or six, and he won. And so the Communist Party had a person on the city council who got the vote on every bill that came up. Promptly after that, proportional representation was removed from the city of New York, and so we now have the winner-take-all system. A few more. A few more. Okay, quickly. Why don't you say anything about wars that cost $30 billion per day? That's a good criticism. You know, there are other things I didn't have time and I didn't talk about, and that's certainly an important one. And that's worth a whole afternoon and evening, both about the politics and the economics of it. The wars are stupefyingly expensive. But it's really not the particular wars I would urge you to think about in economic terms. The United States, and Mr. Obama unfortunately reiterated that the other day, has undertaken the idea that it is the world's policeman. I know we don't like to face that in this country, but that's what we are. No other country on earth has this list of bases around the country that we staff with our military, that we protect with our Navy and Air Force and so forth. No other country on earth can intervene around the world the way the United States, at least, has been able to. No country can survive the failures of its military campaigns the way this country can. I mean, Iraq and Afghanistan, for those of you that are able to face the way the world works, those are failures. We did not achieve any of the goals that could reasonably be listed as what was about in going to these countries. And if you ever doubt that, I suggest you read the press of our competitor European countries. It's very hard to understand the French activities in Algeria, for example, by reading French newspapers, but you can get a real clear idea by reading American or British newspapers. And you can't understand the collapse of the British Empire by reading the British papers. They keep pretending that hasn't happened yet. But it's very hard, if you were once the British Empire, to face the reality that you are now a wet, cold, resourceless island off of the continent. That's very hard. That's very hard. And we should learn about our own culture that way. But if you want to understand the American wars, then pick up the Le Monde Diplomatique. It's the international newspaper, international publication of the single most important newspaper in France, which is called Le Monde. And they put it out in English, and you can get it on the internet. But there you will get the kind of reporting of Afghanistan and Iraq that will give you an idea of what has happened there. Huge amount of money, countries that are totally destroyed, and will be for generations to come, and gotten us, I don't know, the enmity of hundreds of millions of Muslims around the world for all kinds of reasons. It's strange activity. The problem economically is this, and there's no way out of this. We have been a global military power for half a century. And that has developed, as Eisenhower understood so well at the beginning, an enormous vested interest of huge parts of this economy in the maintenance of a military apparatus. They do not want the risks of a transition to some other kinds of industry. It's not that it isn't possible, sure it is. But the way to make a transition, to beat your swords into plowshares, would require massive amount of government planning, massive amount of government subsidy, massive amount of government help in the transition. And the corporations that are now making a fortune off the military are not clear that they would be better off after that happened. And as long as that's not clear to them, they're not gonna go in that direction for all the usual reasons. If you allow corporations to exist under the logic of making money for the shareholders in the state, not only will you continue to have these crises, not only will you continue to have the corruption of politics by the money they wield, but you will have them committed to those kinds of industrial activity that have proven profitable to them and from which they do not want to part without an absolutely iron guarantee that they will be as well off under the new arrangements as under the old. And that's not a guarantee anyone can provide. And by the way, the same thing applies not just to the military industrial complex, but for example, to the pharmaceutical hospital medical complex, which is now the same kind of entrenched apparatus, which is why you got no single-payer health system in this country, why you have to go to Canada to see what it works like, or to Europe to see what it... Every other advanced industrial country has a national health service. We're the only one that doesn't. And the only way to understand that is to realize we're the only country that doesn't have a national health service, and the cost of medical care in the United States is 50% higher than what it is in any other country. And that's because our medical system has to provide profits for hospitals, profits for drug makers, high salaries for medical personnel, etc. It is an amazing study of the dysfunctionality of private enterprise, if ever I saw one. And until these things are addressed as such, we will be tinkering around the edges. Who is going to? Well, the answer is you. Who else? Who else? Who's going to address how to go about it? Who's going to address it? The answer is the American people, in a peculiar way. Not to take away anything that Occupy movement has done, but at a certain point, and this was so clear in New York City, at a certain point, 3 weeks into Occupy the Zuccotti Park in the middle of the Wall Street area, day after day, we all wondered. The New York Times said nothing. It was as if nothing was happening. Suddenly, in a space of 6 or 7 days, it was on the front page. Something happened. Something transformed the situation. And the only thing we can think of was the sheer magnitude of the attraction operated by Zuccotti Park. I don't know if you're aware of it, but for the whole month of October, young people in New York, people going out on dates, you know, romantic dates, went to Zuccotti Park. People with no political interest whatsoever, because it was the place to go. Because that was sexy, that was exciting, that was new. And suddenly, you could not function in New York City. Everybody was talking about it. Everybody was doing 99.1%, 99.1%. It was as if a new Coca-Cola jingle had been developed that nobody could get out of his or her head. And I think there's a clue here. There's a movement. There's something happening. People, it's not that people don't agree with the kinds of things we're saying. They do. The problem isn't agreeing with the idea. The problem is believing it's conceivable to get any of that. Most people agree, but think it's hopeless. What's the point? Everything is stacked against us. The single most important thing Occupy did was to break that down. All the people who agree with you now know they're not alone. It's doing it. It's keeping it going. It's talking to everyone you know. It's staying with these marches, staying with the events. You here have the advantage that it isn't, you know, 18 degrees as it is in New York City, which makes some of these activities a little harder to do. But people are very resourceful. The meetings that I've been going to for the last 6 weeks have taken place in the lobby of the Deutsche Bank headquarters on Wall Street. It's a very large building, very large room, and that's where the Occupy meetings are happening, so long as they don't get kicked out of that area. Okay, quickly, in a little bit of time I have left. In consideration of all the economic global disruption, depression, I don't know where to invest our family's monetary assets for retirement. Well, I can tell you, since I do a little bit of work on Wall Street, that nobody on Wall Street has any idea where to invest money either. It is the most turbulent time down there. All the accepted wisdom has been undone. Nobody knows. Some of you may have noticed that the governor of New Jersey, a man named John Corzine, who used to be the head of Goldman Sachs, is basically worried now about going to jail because of the corporation he set up that bet on what he thought was a sure thing based on his lifetime as an investment banker at Goldman Sachs, and he lost everything and may go to jail because he lost money that wasn't his on top of the money that he did lose. That's a sign of a system that does not know where security is anymore. When the Standard & Poor's Corporation last summer downgraded the security of the United States from AAA to AA, that's a sign that the most secure investment the world knew isn't as secure as it was. These are all, you should understand, these are all small straws in the wind that the existing economic system isn't working. You don't need a Marxist economist, although I would urge you to have one around at all times. You don't need a Marxist economist to tell you this. All that Marx ever figured out was that the capitalist system that other people thought had to be celebrated at all costs had major flaws, major internal contradictions, as he called them, and had the potential to deliver disaster upon disaster to people. When I go around the country and try to summarize, as I have to do now because we've run out of time, I use the following metaphor. If you were trying to understand a family that happened to have a mother, father, and two kids, and you discovered that one of the children believed that he or she had grown up in the best family the world had ever seen, they think their mother and father had the perfect relationship, and it's wonderful. And then you discovered that the other child thought that mother and father were a disaster as individuals and a worse disaster as a couple, and that they had suffered. Okay, if you were trying to understand this family and how it worked, would you talk to only one child, or would you think it necessary to talk to both of them? If you want to understand capitalism, you need to talk to the people who think it's just wonderful. But you also, unless you're a strange person, need to talk to those of us who think it sucks. Because we too have something to say, we too have the apparatus with which to say it, and you're living in an economic system that if you don't think there's something wrong, you really have been asleep. I am, as a last word, I am a Marxist economist, and I'm happy and proud to be one. Thank you very much for your attention.